Hey guys, welcome to all of you on our channel, that is Achieve IAS. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are targeting the exam of civil services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So we also have friend series in which what we do, we daily discuss your Indian Express opinions. So what the purpose of this video is basically to discuss the important opinions or articles or editorials that might have appeared in the newspaper of Indian Express. So today let's see what are the important articles. So first article that we will be discussing is chipping away RTI. So before going into detail about this article, let me tell you that as is clear from its name, this article is about your Right to Information Act. So friends, recently, yesterday, the Indian Express newspaper reported that there have been some rules that have been issued by the Department of Personnel and Training relating to the downgrading of the salary and status of the Chief Information Commission and other information commissioners, and then at the state level also. So what are these basically changes? So as of now, the Chief Information Commission commissioner is equivalent to the chief election commissioner, so or to the judge of the Supreme Court. But now his status has been reduced to as per the recent notification issued by the Department of Personnel and Training, his status has been reduced to that of a cabinet secretary to the government of India. And as of now, the other information commissioners that are there, they have the status of this election simple election commissioners that are there in the election commission of India. But now they in the recently order issued rules, their status has been reduced to that of the secretary to the government of India. So you can read about it here. So basically recently concluded session of the parliament, the government had brought the amendments to the RTI Act, so which were widely criticized, and in pursuance of these amendments the rules have been reported, so as reported in this newspaper, have been adding finishing touches. So what is the basic thing which the author wants to highlight is that sorry friends, there is now starts loading this, but let's see how much time it takes, but we will discuss the important issue. So you can see that the new rules framed by Department of Personnel and Training, yet to be approved by Prime Minister, make the CICI an equivalent of cabinet secretary and central information commissioners the same as secretary to the governments in terms of salary. So also not just this, but the tenure of information commissioner as well as chief information commissioner has been reduced from 5 years to 3. So in the states also downgrading has taken place, and the state information commissioner, chief state information commissioner, has been reduced to the status of secretary to the government of India, and then information commissions have been reduced to the status of the additional secretary to the government of India. So the new rules which in fact some might see it that these new rules are there is nothing new in these rules. They are just we can say as is alleged that they are just a kind of we can say reduction in salary, and to ensure that the salary and the money is not wasted of the government of India. But but the author says that these rules, so the author says that these new rules basically undermine the authority of the entire RTI Act that has been that was framed by the that was termed as one of the most progressive legislations that came into being in the post independent India. So it is not just a matter of reduction of salaries, because but of the stature also, because as of now in the current in the RTI Act in the form it was enacted in 2005, these information commissioners or chief information commissioners didn't had much power, but they could only enforce their orders just by imposing a penalty. So in that case that has been the penalty has not been that much, so only monetary penalty can be imposed. But now if the government departments were giving the information under the provisions of that, it was only because of the stature of the information commissioners or chief information commissioner enjoying the same authority as the chief election commissioner and supreme court judges. So even before this dramatic downgrade, there have been multiple steps that have been taken by different governments at the center and the state level to ensure that to push back from against the promise of transparency that is there in the RTI Act. So appointments have been basically made. There is a criticism that appointments have been made basically to give benefits to favored retired bureaucrats or dispense favors to camp followers. And there has been also many instances in which information commissioners or the CIC have shown enormous reluctance in many states to appoint the full strength of commissioners, leading to large pendency. And other thing is that these commissioners have also returned a large number of complaints and appeals on minor grounds. Even so, the RTI Act, apart from these limitations, so broadly there are three to four limitations, that is they don't have power, and now one more limitation is that they don't have stature, and other thing is that the posts are filled to favor those persons who are in the favor of the government. And then other thing is that full strength of commissioners have been rarely seen in the states, and also then CIC returns a large number of complaints. So even then this RTI Act helped the ordinary citizens feel empowered. So but now this step can effectively downgrade the authority of the RTI Act and may defeat its purpose with which it was brought. So this is basically this article relating to RTI. So now let's move to the next article. So this article is not from your exam point of view, so it is a political article. So it is about elections in Maharashtra. So we will not cover this article, but this article is important, that is Bapu, your work isn't over. So this article has been written by Yugendra K. Alag. So he's a former union minister and also an economist. So the article has been written in the context of 150th birth celebrations of Mahatma Gandhi. So here the author, I will not go into that much detail, so only I will highlight that what the author wants to say. So here the author critically examines the relevance of Mahatma Gandhi's main economic idea. So what do you mean by critically analyze? You can get better idea from the article. So most often questions have been asked in UPSC, that a statement is given to you and you are asked to critically examine. So critically examine means that to look at the positives and the negatives of a particular thing. So here the critical examination of Mahatma Gandhi's main economic ideas has been focused upon. So first is basically first idea that Mahatma Gandhi gave was that the wants should be limited. We should have limited wants. So this is basically important, particularly in the context of a poor economy. So then in this context we also have to provide for future generations and to feed the poor, and if there we consume enough, that leaves little space for the future generations, then that would be termed as unsustainable development. But now the economic policy in today's India, the author highlights that, has turned towards consumption, because now the savings are not seen as as the main driver of the economy, but the consumption is seen as the driving force of economy. So this is here the author states that this is a major mistake, because in Gandhi, Mahatma Gandhi, he said that there must be a minimum want. So in that case the saving should be maximum, but in today's context, if the consumption, now there is a consumption that is the driving force of economy. So if in today's context savings are focused upon, the author says that you could be termed as against the reform. So then such a communication makes consumption both a product and industry. So in today's world, consumption is both a product and industry. So now if China has saving rates of 40% and ours has gone down from 32% to 29%, then you can be termed as against reform, because today it is being claimed claimed by the policy makers as well as leading intellectuals in India that the growth can be consumer driven, consumption driven, not the saving driven. So that is the major departure from Mahatma Gandhi's idea. So other thing is that the burden this consumption puts on the finite resources of the world. So serious question is that obviously if consumption is the main driver of the economy, then that consumption seriously undermines the sustainable development. So here a more serious question is that the world of finite resources in a fundamental sense can't afford such consumption. So for the author highlights that if their per capita consumption exceeds a quarter of the American levels, so even if we start consuming more than a quarter of American level consumption, then the planet can collapse because of the climate change. So this is a major concern. So you can use such ideas in your answers that Mahatma Gandhi was basically when the questions relating to sustainable development or other things are asked to you or environment are asked to you, you can focus upon such things. So consumption, you can also be said to critically examine the current model of economic development. So in such things you can use such ideas. So other thing is that the Mahatma Gandhi focus was self-reliant villages and relevant technology. So here on the last bit the author says that in case of relevant technologies, the villages have certainly improved, but the village is not today self-reliant because in terms of technology, the author highlights V. Kuren, that is the father of white revolution in India. Then at a more basic level, computerization has taken place, communication expansion has taken place, and also fiber optics have expanded. So village is now technologically savvy. So dairy agro-based development has also taken place because dairies are there, and then there are various brands that have been based on such industry, for example Amul, then NDDB, then KVIC. But then self-reliant, here author suggests that today the village is not self-reliant. And also in this context, if the Bapu mentioned the idea of self-reliant in terms of no trade, because Mahatma Gandhi didn't favor the trade, but here the author differs from Mahatma Gandhi because he says that in today's world trade is important. So Mahatma Gandhi was against the trade. So this is important when you are addressing the imperialist. So author says that in times of Mahatma Gandhi, when the Indian economy was governed by imperial government, colonial government, when the trade was in favor of the British, the trade policies were such that it benefited the British and not the Indians. So in that context, it was obvious to criticize trade. But in today's world, when we are ourselves charting out the independent India's path, then it is very important that trade takes place, because through this growth can take place. So here author says that yes, there can be possibility that can that trade can degenerate into exploitation, but after independence we can elect regimes or governments which regulate fairly. So if they don't, we must change them. So yes, Mahatma Gandhi made us a mighty machine. So now we are 100 crore people capable of achieving every goal, and we are unbeatable if the goal is clear and if we are organized for it. But various kinds of work that Mahatma Gandhi have left, they are yet to be done. So for example, whether will we love the neighbor or will we be your Vaishnav Jan. So Mahatma Gandhi's concept of Vaishnav Jan, and then the tear that is there in the eyes of villager or agriculturist or farmer, then this is also an issue. So here author says that we still need Mahatma Gandhi in many of the things. So in fact, it is not a doubt, it is not just just the opinion of the this author, but of leading intellectuals in India, that Mahatma Gandhi's leading intellectuals of not just India but also of the world, that Mahatma Gandhi's ideas, Mahatma Gandhi, there is very much need of Mahatma Gandhi's idea in today's world. But it is not just need of it, but we have to, we can say, abide by them if we have a minutest of belief in morality and ethics. And then this is your second article that we have discussed, and your third article is relating to nutrition is no puzzle. So this article has been written in the context of Global Hunger Index that has been released recently by this Welt Life Hunger. So more details about this we will be discussing separately, because in yesterday's newspaper, the explained part of the Indian Express had given a comprehensive coverage to this topic. So we will not waste our time focusing upon on this article, because that will be covered in separate article. So let's see now to the next article which we will be discussing. So this article is A Space for the Future. So this is article basically is context of the Ayodhya verdict that is about to come. So there is not much that can be discussed in this article, but the brief idea of this case is that of this article is that the author highlights that Supreme Court has played an important role so far as charting out the journey of independent India is concerned. So in ensuring, in deepening the democracy, in deepening every ideal that is enshrined in the Constitution, Supreme Court has played its role, and it has not just always followed the public mood, but has also sometimes stood against it, and has time and again restored rationality in place of public mood. So this author highlights in the context of recent Supreme Court observation which it made in the context of Kashmir, in which it said that collective mood of the nation is that is in the favor of complete integration of Kashmir. So but then author says that such kind of issues are like now apart from Kashmir, the Ayodhya issue is such kind of a issue in which the Supreme Court can't go by the public mood. It must be rational, so it must announce judgment keeping both the sides in mind and giving a balanced judgment, balancing the interests of both the parties, different parties, different stakeholders that are involved in it. So if not, then if the Supreme Court decision went by the public mode, or if it doesn't follow its conscience, then certainly our future generations are bound to suffer from this indecision that the Supreme Court may give then. So it is better if Supreme Court gives fair judgment. So this is basically the article, so you can read about it in more detail. So now let's move on to the next question. Next is next article. So this article is basically about the police reform. So the heading is reform, not compliance. So the article has been written by Yashovardhan Azad. So he's a retired IPS officer. So in this context, the author highlights various problems that are there with the police, and recently it also talks about the Common Cause survey, in which it has been reaffirmed that the black sheep in the police force find nothing wrong with the beating up criminals to extract a confession. So this is one of the biggest issues of the police, the torture that in custody takes place, which lead to sometimes custodial deaths also. So here then author highlights that there was an article that was published in 27 September issue of Indian Express, in which suggested that this torture is endemic to Indian policing. But the author here opposes this this viewpoint that this torture is endemic, because author says that there are still overwhelming majority of IPS officers and other police officers in the country that are against this torture, and they value human rights and also human dignity. So torture, he also says that then torture is not justified under any circumstances, because it is not just wound on the body, but it is wound in the soul, that demeans the society. So here the author says that the thing is that India signed a UN convention against torture in 1997, but it is yet to ratify this treaty, because it has not enacted law in this respect that is necessary to ratify the treaty. For example, because India has signed the treaty in 1997, so this convention was signed in 1997, but it has not, but the government of India has not enacted law on torture, so that's why it has not been ratified. So then author says that but it is not necessary then that we have no such mechanism that can be followed to address the problem of torture that the police exercises on the detainees. So here there are many instruments. For example, there is a kind of, we can say, if custodial death takes place, or in case of a death, the police custody, if there is any death in case or other case of death in police custody, so it is inquired by the magistrate in some cases, and sometimes also judicial inquiry can be ordered. And then there are also criminal cases under substantive sections can also be instituted against the police, accused policemen. So there have been also directions that complaints against policemen have been filed in courts. So courts are listening to the people concerned, and complaints are filed, and also then directions have been issued. For example, installation of CCTV cameras covering hawalat rooms in police station has been made mandatory. And then there is National Human Rights Commission Act that acts as a watchdog of human rights. But then there is the issue that why then again time and again such cases still come to light, because if there are so much things, the National Human Rights Commission is there, court listening to the victim is there, under the criminal procedure code there are different provisions in which the proceedings can take place, and then judicial inquiry or inquiry by the magistrate can be there, then why such things time and again happen. So here author highlights that the state must take the responsibility of fixing these instruments to ensure that they deliver justice to the victims of human rights abuse, because if various guidelines that have been given by the Supreme Court are not followed, then certainly it is the responsibility of the state to ensure that they are followed. So it must also then follow the directive. So in 2006, Supreme Court gave comprehensive guidelines relating to police reforms, for example, setting up of a police complaints authority in every state of India. So such things it is necessary that state can take undertake to ensure that there is minimum resort to torture. So here author highlights that this convention against torture and other cruel, inhuman or degrading treatment or punishment was adopted by UN General Assembly on December 10, 1984, and it came into force in 1987. So in November 2017, the Law Commission of India in its 273rd report recommended that the government should ratify the convention. So please note this, in 2017, Law Commission recommended this in its 273rd report. And then Law Commission also presented a draft of a new prevention of torture bill to the government, which has not yet been adopted. But then here author highlights the earlier article which was published on 27 September, the author in which highlights that this enactment of act has not taken place. The author criticizes this point because just ratification is not a panacea for the ills of the torture, because there are still countries in 160 nations which have enacted laws on torture to ratify the treaty, but then there is the cases of police torture still surface in these countries. So in South Asia also, detainee torture and custodial death remain at a disturbingly high level. For example, in Pakistan also, in which treaty is both signed as well as ratified, and then Afghanistan also this has been the case, and then in case of China also this is the case that ratification has taken place, but torture is still taking place despite the existence of anti-torture law. So here it will be unfair if we expect that all the problem will be solved by prevention of torture bill. So also here author highlights that it is necessary that we look closer at the reality of policing in India. So here author highlights that there are many police stations that are in outlying rural areas that have very basic technology, or they even lack this basic technology or forensic aid or materials for crime detection. detection. So such lack of technology and forensic aid and material for crime detection, and then lack of mobile phone communications, and then other issues, for example roads. This single police station can be seen after 70 to 80 villages in large states. So crime is rampant. So obviously the infrastructure is very poor. So in this context, the burden on the police personnel that are working in such circumstances is very high. So it is so they basically simply in such pressure they forget about they resort to we can say torture, and then to extract confessions. So then author then also highlights that there are severe manpower deficit issues that have been seen, and because India's police force is grossly overworked. So there is heavy pendency of work, and also there is political interference. So work stress is also inordinately high, and there is urgency, there is pressure on to improve the crime detection rate is a matter of constant worry. So all this regrettably does make the police lose patience in trying to bring cases to a quick culmination. So here the author says that these are not just pocketful of ready excuses. So these are not just excuses, because this is also a reality. So it is necessary, it is better if we accept such things. So this is author again highlights that this is also not justification of torture, but we can say in simple words, if you want to solve a problem, then you must diagnose what the problem is. So here author says that rickety infrastructure with any facility, without any facility, and then it cannot inspire any high grade or enlightened policing. So all police stations, it is necessary that they are provided these basic amenities and connectivity. So state of the art technology is needed for such in such police stations, so as to promote hassle-free interrogation and crime detection. So also then there is need of training the police force at regular intervals, and special training should also be imparted to the police personnel by the CIB, CBI on questioning suspects. But also then there must also be refresher courses like in other job profiles, because police is surely overburdened. And then also these then there are the time and again various issues have been identified with the working of the police, but long pending gaps in criminal justice system they must be addressed, but not just they must be, we can say, identified, because already they have the identification has been there. So like there is clear idea that there must be separation of law and order and investigation being at police stations, and then strengthening prosecution apparatus and provision of legal advisors in the district police setup. So all these will enable the police supervisory structures to reduce torture to a great extent. So then author says that it may sound ironical, but it is necessary that we promote the ease of doing policing, because doing policing in India is very difficult. So basically the author writes the article from the perspective from the position of a police personnel. So obviously author says that it may sound ironical that empowering police how it can lead to improvement in the working of the policing, but then it is a harsh reality, because that would be first step in the in reducing this practice of torture. Because if we promote ease of doing policing, and we take measures, well established measures for fixing accountability, and then this could be basically this torture practice can be reduced. So then there is also necessary that recruitment process should look at the issues like taking psychoanalytical tests, because if for example people who have that ingrained attitude of brutality, they are weeded out before entering into the force. So ratification, at the end author concludes that ratification of the UN Convention against Torture, it is not just enough passing law, but it must be ratification must also be in letter and spirit, and we must also upgrade the infrastructure and then ease the pressure on the police force and should ramp up the capacities of the police force, and then we can certainly enact the prevention of torture bill. So that will be a good step in that direction, but if we say that alone that can be the solution, that is not the thing. So it will be just another exercise of official compliance to free your conscience. Unless and until we don't reform the police, then nothing is going to work. So this is basically the point that the author wants to highlight. So here, this article, about this article I have already explained. So now the last article of the day that we are going to discuss is the path to the peace. So here we will be not discussing much detail. We will be not be discussing in much detail the entire thing that is there in this article. So the broad idea of this article is that this article is written in relation to the Naga peace talks that are going between government of India and the Naga Socialist Council of that is NSCN that is of National Socialist Council of Nagalim, Isaac Moya. So peace talks are going between the government of India and this organization, and in 2015 the government of India and this organization announced that they have reached a framework agreement. But then author highlights that there are the core concern of that this organization was to get sovereignty. So but then now they have in principle agreed to give up that sovereignty as per different reports, the reports, or we can say sources. It has been found that it has been claimed that the NSCN IM has given up its hard stance of ensuring the sovereignty and territorial integrity, because there are basically three or four demands of this organization and National Socialist Council of Nagalim that basically represent the Nagaland Naga people, that they must be given sovereignty and then territorial integrity, and there must also be then integration of other areas in different states that where the Nagas live. The demand is that these areas in which Nagas live in other states, that these areas must be merged with Greater Nagalim. So, but then the reports have been found that the organization has given up both these demands, that is of sovereignty and then also of your integration of all the contiguous Naga areas. Other thing in this context, the author says that they have little through which they can claim that they have won. They have won their demands. For example, if there was a demand of separate Naga flag and separate constitution, and that possibility has also been reduced because of the recent measure of the government of India to abrogate the Article 370 that provided the same thing to the Jammu and Kashmir residents. So in that case, author says that it is the NSCN IM has hardly any point by using which it can claim that it has won the deal. So, but then author says that the timeline that has been given by the center, 3 months timeline that is given to the interlocutor. The interlocutor, name of the interlocutor is basically R.N. Ravi, who is the governor of Nagaland also. So Prime Minister had asked him to conclude the talks in 3 months, in August month. So it was reported. But then author says that the government must not insist on 3 month deadline, because it can take the entire peace process or entire talk process to nowhere, and the talk process, it is quite possible that it can fail. So obviously center should show the flexible attitude and must keep on nudging the organization and must keep on engaging with the organization to keep the talks on. But They must be final as soon as possible, but the government should resist from insisting on the timeline that is provided by the Prime Minister that is reported in August month. So this is all about, friends, today's discussion. So if you like this video, if you like the discussion, then do ensure that you like our video, share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel. So this is all about, friends, today's video. Thank you. Have a very nice day ahead.